Good evening and welcome to Metro Focus. I'm Jenna Flanagan.
Melissa Mark Bibarito arrested. The former city council speaker was among several protesters detained outside the Museum of Modern Art. Mark Bibarito was calling for the ouster of one of the board's trustees, who she accuses of profiting from Puerto Rico's debt crisis. The former speaker can be seen in photos being handcuffed and escorted away by cops. All this takes place just weeks after Mark Bibarito threw her hat into the race for New York's 15th congressional district in the Bronx. The current congressman, Jose Serrano, announced he will not seek re-election in 2020 due to his recent Parkinson's diagnosis. Serrano held the seat for 16 terms. Other competitors vying for the seat include State Assemblyman Michael Blake and New York City Council members Richie Torres and Ruben Diaz Sr.
So here with her take on the issues and her primary challengers is former Council Speaker Melissa Mark Bibarito. Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much.
Or welcome back, I should say. So first off, tell me, why are you running for this seat?
You know, we're in a really fragile moment in our democracy. We have an administration that is wreaking havoc, that is instilling fear and sowing division in this country. And the issues that we care about, that many of us might care about, are really front and center of the attacks of this administration. When you think of immigrant communities, when you think about people of color, when you think of Muslims, when you think of Puerto Ricans and the issues of the aftermath of Hurricane Maria, this is a real moment where we have to have an aggressive, an unapologetic leader who's willing to stand up to this administration and that is going to fight on behalf of the constituents and the district to ensure that their needs are being served and that they're front and center in whatever the work is that I will do as their congressional representative. So this is really, to me, a call to action. There is no time to waste. Mm-hmm. I feel the sense of urgency. It impacts me in terms of mentally and emotionally because I am concerned very much about where we are, but I'm concerned particularly about the children, about the separation of families. When I think about people that still don't have roofs over their head, they're still suffering the consequences of climate change. There's so much that we have to do. So to me, it was urgent to really step up and say that I have a lot more to give and I want to be that voice for the 15th Congressional District.
Of course. And as we mentioned earlier in the lead, that there are several other Democrats who are also vying for this seat. Now, I'm sure there's going to be a lot that happens in this primary, but an easy target for a lot of people is going to say, well, you don't even live in the district.
So I represented in the Bronx for 12 years, four of those years as speaker, so a citywide platform. My record of accomplishment is very clear, and I will put that record obviously out there as we campaign. And also I have deep roots in this borough. My mother was born and raised in the Bronx, born in the old Lincoln Hospital. And my grandfather lived in Co-op City, and so I visited the Bronx all summers when I used to visit from Puerto Rico. So my roots are deep. My track record is very clear. But I think what people really want is they want someone who they see as a fighter. That green taxi driver that I met just yesterday, Leoncio, who stopped me on the street because he recognized me and said in Spanish to me that I represented him and that he was proud because I always fought for him and that he saw me as a fighter who was going to bring justice and equity. That, to me, is what this is about. People that see that fearlessness in terms of my fight and my demands, that we create a more just and equitable country. And I think that the track record that I have at a local level of having done that in the city of New York speaks to it. I'm an activist at the end of the day. And it is about fighting the inequities that exist in this system. And this system is rigged very much against the Leoncios, the hardworking class people, and him and those he represents, and those that I want to represent in this congressional district. So it is about unrigging this system and bringing more fairness and equity, and I want to be that voice for this district.
Okay, but again, just to be clear for people, that you do live in East Harlem and not officially in the district.
I am one subway stop from the district, and I will be living in this district once I am elected and probably a little bit before that. I don't know the timeline, but definitely my concern, right, first and foremost, is what is the vision that I want to share with those that I seek to represent, those who already have a relationship with me, either because I directly represented them as their council member or because they saw me at that citywide platform really fighting and advocating for their needs, for the undocumented immigrants in this city and making sure that they felt welcome, because we know what vibrancy they bring to the city of New York. When we talk about criminal justice reform and closing down Rikers Island and looking at the humanization of those who are incarcerated and helping them reintegrate successfully into our communities, this is about equity and justice. And that belongs to everybody, regardless of where you live. And so that is the vision that I bring to this district when we talk about fighting poverty, when we talk about bringing better quality housing, when we talk about job creation and making sure whatever development and whatever progress we're seeing is one that benefits the residents first and foremost of the district. So this is really going to be a great race, and that I'm going to be able to share those accomplishments and my vision. And I believe that that will resonate with every single person in this district.
Well, I'm sure, as you may or may not know, we've already had one of your contenders, Councilman Richie Torres, on the show. We spoke to him about why he was running for the race, and specifically, we did ask him about you. He ran to be city council speaker and did not win that race. You did, but we did want to get his thoughts on you running the race, and this is what he had to say.
I'm the best candidate. I'm rooted in the Bronx. I have 6 years of governing experience with investigations, with overseeing the largest landlord in the United States. But I also have lived experience. I know what it's like to struggle, right? Whether it's criminal justice reform or mental health or housing or healthcare. I know those issues because I've lived them firsthand.
All right, so very quickly, what are your reactions to the councilman's thoughts?
So again, I think this is about what is the moment that we're living in, and what does this moment call for? I am an activist and fighting for inequality, against inequality and against injustice. I have been arrested fighting these policies of the Trump administration. When we talk about creating a city where everyone feels validated and valued, that is really what is going to be at stake here, is about what have you done with the influence and the platform that you've been provided. As a council member, that activism is basically what I brought to the table when I was leading in the district and when I was leading the city of New York, and people remember that. So I think that what they need, the moment that we're living in now, calls for unapologetic, unwavering progressiveness and a fighter for equity and justice. And I have been that absolutely, consistently. I have not faltered in that. And I think that that's what people see. People are frustrated, as the taxi driver that I alluded to.
Of course, yes.
That cannot make ends meet, that is suffering depression. And he talked about it openly to me, to say, I fear because I cannot provide for my family. We live in a country of so much wealth. When we talk about the healthcare needs of constituents, when we talk about being able to provide for your family and having a job where you are being able to be compensated to achieve that, that is the American dream. That is what everybody aspires to do here. And there are many hardworking people that are being left behind. So that is what this is about, is about who's going to get results in an environment where we want to change the dynamics at the national level.
Well, let me ask you this then, because of course, New Yorkers, this is very much a city of, well, what have you done for me lately? So as you go forward with this campaign, are there going to be any specific things that you're going to be able to point to from your time as council speaker that you accomplished on behalf of either specifically residents in the Bronx or just the city overall?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, when you talk about the conversation where we're at now, where we're talking about closing Rikers Island, I led that fight. I created the independent commission. I brought great minds around the table through the leadership of Judge Lippman to that conversation, where we're re-envisioning what does reform or the justice system look like in the city of New York. When we talk about our undocumented neighbors and individuals in the city of New York and creating a legal fund for unaccompanied minors, when we talk about a legal fund for those who are facing deportation proceedings and investing taxpayer dollars in that, I was heavily criticized for that. But I knew it was the right thing to do. And in this time of Trump, that legal fund is literally saving people's lives. So this is about vision, right? And when we talk about ICE and people talk about abolishing ICE, we implemented, and I was the lead sponsor of legislation to get ICE out of Rikers Island, where we literally had ICE agents that were in Rikers Island. And when advocates came to me, and this is before I was speaker, and said, we need to do something about this, I championed that bill against a lot of odds. So this is about a vision that is outside of the box thinking, that we can accomplish, what can you accomplish in the platform that you've been provided and with the influence that you have before you. The work that I have done has changed the lives of New Yorkers. I want to take that to a national level. We can do these same kinds of policies and advocate for this inequity to unrig the system, to talk about systemic racism. How do we change that? How do we eradicate it? What policies can we enact and really scale that up and fight for that equity and justice that we all deserve?
You know, there's so much, unfortunately, but right now there's so much cynicism, I think, amongst the general electorate when it comes to politics, politicians, et cetera, and do you really care? So before I let you go, I do want to ask you, should this not work out, what kind of, I mean, you were talking about being an activist. Where does that energy go? Where does that dedication, that passion go that says, no, I'm actually in this long term for the people?
Well, I mean, change comes in many different ways, right? I believe I will win this race. But if I don't, definitely there's ways that you can support what I was doing just before, helping get people of similar mindsets elected to office, increasing the number of women and women of color who are running and who win their campaigns. That is a way that we're going to change the reality we live in. We need to create greater balance in terms of gender equity still to this day in politics, but also in policymaking positions. And we have to fight for that. And so that's something I really believe in. We need to make sure that women are stepping up to the challenge, but that we create the opportunities for them to succeed. That is still something very relevant in this day, despite the progress we've achieved. But we have an administration that is deeply set on rolling back a lot of the accomplishments that we as women have achieved, particularly around reproductive rights. And there is a candidate in this race who does not believe in my right for reproductive freedom. And we have to ensure that a vision like that is not what is representing this district and is not in the halls of Congress.
All right, so Council Speaker Melissa Mark Viverito, thank you so much for joining us. And of course, we'll be following this race very closely.
Yes.
We'll be inviting the other major candidates running in the Democratic primary for the seat in the 15th Congressional District. So stay tuned.